to welcome as our chairman for this session, Sir Anthony Dymock, who I never had the pleasure of working for in the Royal Navy. Reaching three-star rank, he commanded three ships, fought in a couple of British scuffles, coalition scuffles, the Falklands and one of the Gulf Wars. He's commanded at three frigates, the British task groups, moved on then to staff jobs, became the British Defence Attaché in Washington, running the British Defence Staff, and ended up as the UK permanent representative in NATO. Since leaving the Royal Navy in 2008, my goodness, that's getting on, sir, he has shifted into assisting governments and institutions write maritime strategy. There are few people that have been more alive to how maritime security has shifted and changed in the last 10 to 15 years, but with an institutional memory that stretches back into an era that modern thinkers and scholars sometimes find it quite hard to identify with. Sir Anthony, it's all yours.
Thank you for that tepid introduction. Welcome to this session. I forgive Malcolm Chalmers for overrunning because I think we had some real quality in that session. It was explained that I'm a retired admiral. What I've done since actually is relevant to this in that I'm a symptom of Europe's difficulty in getting its act together on maritime security. Wise Pens International is basically five retired vice admirals from France, Germany, Spain, Italy, and UK. And the reason we exist at all is that the EU, while very good at integrating its maritime security policy under the Commission, is almost incapable of doing it on a civ mil basis and including the defence element of maritime security, even though it's only relevant to 19 of the 28 member states. Those 19 do find it difficult looking at the present and looking at the future in the context of maritime security policy inside and outside Europe with great difficulty. So this session is entitled Potential Crisis Management Roles for Europe, which does presuppose that the EU is capable of crisis management, and that's an open but different question. But I do think we need to move from hand-wringing over recent history in the South China Sea and elsewhere in the region to looking at what possible future options we might find for crisis prevention as well as crisis management. And it seems to me that the EU faces a classic political dilemma, diplomatic dilemma, in what is not yet a crisis, but could very rapidly become one. It knows what it should do, but finds it very difficult to respond in a coherent way at anything other than the basic common denominator level. The EU struggles to achieve unity. It fears the judgment of the US, and it's liable to disappoint its own aspirations as a supporter of international law. The legal and moral position is actually clear enough, and it's been helpfully sanctified by the recent Court of Arbitration decision in the Hague Tribunal. But China has still managed to pursue its aims incrementally, very effectively, both by checkbook diplomacy and by keeping its level of incremental aggression to a sufficiently low level, and also by simultaneously managing to divide potential regional opposition. And that's obviously as a result of their economic dependency. But to an extent, the EU does share some of that economic dependency, because a good slice of the $5 trillion of trade that goes through the South China Sea belongs to the EU. So it's got real financial skin in the game. How you quantify that risk is a different issue, but there is substance. Doing nothing is clearly an unattractive option. So how does the EU cope with China's economic statecraft that's steadily undermining Europe's values? How does the EU seize the initiative and a degree of control over a deteriorating situation and avoid simply waiting for China to precipitate a crisis at its time of its own choosing? I hope our speakers have got the answers. There are tools available, but identifying them, deciding how to use them, who uses them, when you use them, is actually a very subtle diplomatic process. But given the talent of our two next speakers, I'm sure we'll make progress. We have Vice Admiral Yoji Koda, who was the fleet commander of the Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Force. And since he's retired, he's been very active in both history and international relations, and speaks not just from a Japanese perspective, but with time at Harvard and the US Naval War College, he understands both sides of the Pacific extremely well. Admiral.
I'm a refugee in digital. So. Okay. This morning and first half of in this afternoon, the European speakers spoke from the European point of view. So I'm going to provide the Asian personal point of view, a little different. And also, I promise I narrow the subject. And sorry, I just put the Union Jack, and should be the EU flag, but sorry, you know. When I think the Russia, always the UK comes first, so this is my apology. Japanese always start from the apology. And Europeans or Americans always start from joke, you know. So apology first. And good news, just yesterday, the fourth Japanese helicopter ASW carrier, Kaga, commissioned. So now the four ASW task group of our fleet, each has its own helicopter carrier. Ready, China. Okay, today I'm going to speak, most likely because of my time constraints, I have some good subject on North Korea, but most likely I'm going to speak only on China. Mainly South China Sea. And even today's presentation, many said disputed South China Sea. What's dispute? There are single dispute, that's the territorial dispute. But the two other things are totally different. So we have to reorganize what's happening there. One is, of course, territorial dispute, and this is clear. Like Japan or US are outside, geo-outsiders, so we have nothing to do. Those are the matters for the nation concerned. So yes, what China says exactly, US, Japan, you're outside, get out. Yes, we are getting out. So regional nations should solve the problem by themselves. But there is one condition. If China uses the military power to solve the issue, we preserve the right to come and intervene. But as long as the issue will be treated benignly and peacefully, this is the matter of the regional nations. So US and Japan has nothing to do with that. And the second, artificial island or land reclamation. This relates to two things. One, the disputes, and also the free use of the sea. But this is the big Chinese challenge against the international norm, especially the UNCLOS. And the third one is the high sea or free use of sea or so-called nine dash line. And try to make some part of the water under their jurisdiction and try to apply their domestic law in the area and making the used to be international water their domestic water. So free use of the sea is not easy, but those artificial island making and free use of the sea, this is a universal principle and right for all the human beings. So even the Vatican or Switzerland in Europe, Every nation has the right to come and say something and do something. If any nation that believes this tenet, and if not, like the land power, and try to make the international water to its own water, it's okay. Join the Chinese side. But we strongly believe these two, second or third issue, that's the matter for the US and Japan. We are the stakeholders. So China often says US and Japan are outsiders, go out. No. As long as we deal with these two matters, we come and say something, and when necessary, we do something. This is our position. And one thing note is after the July last year, the rulings were issued, China officially had kept on using the nine dash line until about October period. But my observation, since last Shanshan Forum in October, since then, Chinese stopped using the nine dash line officially. I may be wrong, but as long as I observe, China seemed stopped using the nine dash line. So this is one thing it's better to note. The first subject, territorial disputes. Okay, Spratlys, there are about 200 rocks, lands, and unfortunately, China did not control any of those big land. There are 13 large land, larger than the two soccer field. And 13 of them, six are Filipino control, five under Vietnamese, one Taiwan, and one Malaysia. So China didn't have any land in Spratlys until recently. Okay. This is the nature of the territorial dispute. And this is the list. And in the middle, this is the practical and the controllers and claimants. So basically, China claims everything. Taiwan claims everything. But depending on the situation, the Vietnamese also claims many of them. So this is the situation. But again, I repeat, those are the issues solved by the regional nations. So Japan and US will keep neutrality. It's clear. Even we do not support China, nor any regional nations. But if China uses power, no. The story could be different. Okay, now the artificial islands and land reclamation. The position of China. Why does international community attack only me? There are many other nations doing this. It's the child fight. You know? He's doing, I can do that. This is not the matter for the big country like China, should say. But reality, okay, China made about 13,000 square kilometer reclamation. This is just equivalent of the 400 meters and 3.3 kilometers multiplied by three. And Vietnam and Taiwan, Filipino, and Malaysia, very small. And those four nations has been making the reclamation for 40 years. For example, Malaysia made their swallow reef for the scuba diving spot for the young girls. No military use. China could be different. And this is the Vietnam. So Spratly Island is one of the largest islands in the Spratly Islands. And Vietnamese, in last 2 years, I think this is a counteraction toward the Chinese reclamation, but they hugely expanded. I tried to make the size the same and the scale the same. This can tell how the Vietnamese did. But basically, Vietnamese reclaimed the area around the existing big island. And the same as the Ituaba, Taiwan. The Taiwan built the new port, and yellow circle just expanded a little bit. Okay. And this is the other island, the Situ Island, and the famous swallow reef, Malaysia. There are one runway at each island. And also China in the Woody Island. Chinese reclamation right there, red circle. So 2014 and 17. So this happens in also the Paracel Island. But these are, we call the expansion of the island. But what happened in Spratlys by China? Totally different. But this is then the chronological pictures at the fiery close. So starting from zero, nothing over the surface, to the 3 kilometer runway with good port. And from zero means the low tide elevation. So there's nothing. Even the tide is low, very shallow lagoons. And in 2 years period, China made that island. So this is not a expansion of the existing land. This is just building from zero, okay? And the same is true. This is the fire clause. And just 1 year ago, China sent the first aircraft to the island. The Subi, the same. Please note a date. 13th of July last year. What's the date? Next day of the verdict. Challenging. Great. And the mischief, the same. 13th of July. Next day of the ruling, China sent one aircraft. Okay, I do not cover deeply, but this is all the subject ruling covered. Basically, it could say no on the Chinese 9-dash line or reclamation, almost everything what China claimed. And, but how many of you can read Chinese characters? China said, no, I do not accept anything. This is just a piece of cake, paper, and should be sent to the trash. Good enough. China has the right to say. And one thing associated with is the commercial development or the militarization. And the lower picture is that picture I get 3 years ago in Beijing. And Beijing said, no, we are building the resort for ladies. Okay, I trusted them, but actually, what has been happening there seems the upper pictures. So the last August, BBC reported, is this anything wrong? Is China is in full compliance with the Xi Jinping, the Barack Obama agreement in September 2015? Actually not. So this is a photo picture and satellite photo. The right-hand picture is a satellite photo of the Udi Island. Fighter jet already, pictures are taken. And also this one is the picture released a month ago. This is the S-300 or 400 anti-air missiles potential. Still, missile itself was not confirmed. But those missiles were deployed all of the three islands with the airstrip. Okay. And what's the next hotspot? You know, of course, everybody knows the Scarborough Shoal, about 300 kilometers west of the Philippines, and big enough to receive 2 carrier battle group at the lagoon. And if this is my concept, but China may build the artificial island with 2 airstrips, because this is isolated place, so they need multiple runway for the accident. And if this is complete, this is the picture I used last year, but strategic triangle in the middle of the South China Sea will be completed. So key thing is, can we stop there, their attempt or not, at the Scarborough? Because thanks to the US silence for 8 years, China already established de facto or fait accompli at the Spratlys. So China already developed the line from Sanya, Udi Island, to the Spratlys. The one spot left is Scarborough. So this will be the other hot spot. And just only one hard response by the Obama administration was the low flying over of the Chinese survey ship in last April. China sent a several survey ship for the coming land reclamation, and U.S. detected that, and U.S. picked six A-10 tank attacking aircraft from Korea and made air refueling and sent to the Philippines and made a low pass over those Chinese ships. Beijing got scared. Since then, no action. This is the power. This is the power. Okay? The negotiation sometimes alone, please think about that. Last 8 years, what happened? Are we able to stop Chinese wild attempt? No. They just established de facto. But this one barely stopped the Chinese further attempt to proceed to the reclamation at Scarborough. This is the latest. And okay, what's the Chinese position? Okay. Chinese forced deployment over the reclaimed island is the right as a sovereign nation, self-defense measures. Those are the area that belongs to China indisputably since 260 years before Christ. Good enough. But Xi Jinping agreed, okay, no militarization. But China, instead of that, said, Batman is the United States. Freedom of navigation is the destabilizing factor. U.S. presence itself is the militarization. U.S. joint exercise with regional nation is the militarization. China wisely and willfully transformed the fundamental of the issue and made the bad guy, shift the bad guy from China to the United States. Very wise, I respect. Okay, then the third subject, high sea or the local sea. And of course, Japan, USA, and most of the EU's seafaring nations, high sea is of course the free use for everybody. So if I borrow the Chinese term, indisputable universal concept and rights for human beings. But instead, China said, China still preserved this pretty strong DNA as a ground power. This is my water, Chinese water. And Chinese jurisdiction is in effect. And Chinese domestic law will be in effect. And this is the restricted waters for international or outer players. And no free use. And at the same time, China says free use will be guaranteed. What does it mean? Yes, I'm for sure China will guarantee the free transit. But please think about that. What China is doing now today against South Korea? China is strongly against the third deployment, right? So just about 2 weeks ago, China stopped importing the Chinese automobile by the reason of the safety. One day prior to that, China imported 1,000 per day. And suddenly stopped the South Korean car import by the reason of the safety. If the safety is the reason, are we say anything? Can we say anything toward China? No. Safety or environment, that's the good means. So if I apply this analogy to this area, if China doesn't like the French conduct, for example, France wants to sell something to India, and China gets angry? No, no, no. French ship is violating the Chinese regulation of the environment. We'll stop your ship forever. No? No, not forever, but this is, and if this happens, maybe Russia will apply the same thing in the Arctic. Brazil will apply the same thing to the South Atlantic. Chain reaction would happen. This is one of the reasons, untold reasons, but why we, Japan and the United States, are making the vocal war by the exchange of the hard wording with China. And Japan and US, perhaps, I believe, are not in a position to accept anything that China says. We do not tolerate. So
Genesis summary. The position of Japan, territorial dispute, neutrality. If China uses power, different. So what EU will do? I don't have any answer. But most likely, we do not expect you to physically deploy the power. But this is the fight of the concept or universal philosophy. So major player will be US and Japan, perhaps Australia, and some other like-minded people, a nation. But we do want the psychological and spiritual support in this issue. And artificial island building. China already established the de facto and out of UNCLOS. Of course, depends on the interpretation. But this is also the matter of the international cooperation. If we tolerate Chinese conduct, similar thing may happen in other areas of the region too, on this planet. Are we going to keep silent? When necessary, we need to take some actions. But in this case, perhaps US still preserve the right to use power. And Japan will in full support of the US maneuver as the closest allied nation. And Japan is hosting 70,000 fighting forces, Navy, Air Force, and Marine. In Europe, NATO, there are 80,000, but divided into UK, Italy, and Germany. Japan is hosting the single US carrier strike group stationed outside the United States. It's our responsibility to keep the safety of those forces. US amphib too, US Marines. So that's our responsibility, but again, we do not expect US to come and project power. We want you to clearly show your concept that we share in common. And the third, I see clear. If you think you are the believer of the universal rights or indisputable universal rights of the human being, please come with us. Again, the spiritual, the support. And if you can, of course, it's better to send some real powers. But of course, each nation has its own different the national interest. So depending on EU interest and national interest, what we expect you is to at least make a spiritual support. And North Korea, too many good stories, but I'm going to stop here. Yeah, and you can ask me any questions. Really hot spot, but I'll stop here. Thanks, sir.
Well, thank you. I think you've made the case for the prosecution abundantly clear. And somewhat disappointingly, you've let the Europeans off the hook for doing more than providing moral support. Mm-hmm. Perhaps, Alessio, you have a different perspective.
I shall. Right. Good afternoon, everyone. As it is fashionable, I'd like to thank the organisers for having me here today. I think Peter asked me to speak because I tend to be naughty in my remarks, so the disruptive force of this panel apparently is falling upon my shoulders. And also because when it comes to Europe, I'm always fascinating. Whenever someone sort of set the question as potential crisis management role for Europe, it always leaves me wondering. As an Italian national operating in the UK, married to a French woman with an English son, I should have a natural answer to it, and yet I don't. So it is particularly sort of good to be here and try to address you on this question that was presented to us about potential crisis management for Europe, what Asian want and what can we deliver. And it seems to me that this requires two preliminary issues, which somewhat were assumed, especially in the introductory remarks. First of all, what is the level of crisis we're talking about? What is a crisis? I'll come back to this point in a moment. And secondly, I think partly the answer to this is how it connects. You know, what do we consider a crisis? I think has to be connected to the kind of interests that one has, the strategic and security interest that one has, which obviously brings about the question of what Europeans want from Asia. But then the second preliminary issue to address is what it is Europe. Is Europe as individual state actors, Europe as the EU, Europe as NATO? So let me address the first two preliminary questions before I go further into my remarks. It is, frankly, quite objectively, and honestly, now there's a shooting like 10 meters down the road, so that's probably one thing that has to be put in perspective. But the assumption in the question, crisis management, it presupposes that there are no crises. But as Admiral Koda was mentioning a moment ago, there is a fair argument to set forth that there are already some degree of crisis unfolding. And here I'll mention just the last three that were mentioned in the news over the last week. I'm not going too much far back in time. I'm just, you know, sticking to the last week. So over the last couple of weeks, and this morning was ended this phase, we've heard that North Korea has been playing naughty again, firing missiles right, left, and center. There were four missiles launched a couple of weeks ago, less than sort of 10 days ago. Another one that was was launched today, but it failed actually to take off after a few seconds. The news also reported, Reuters was reported, that the Canadian embassy in Beijing has presented privately to the Chinese government a letter that was jointly signed by another 11 embassies in Beijing concerning serious and grave situation of human rights in China, in particular the mistreatment of human rights lawyers that are currently held in prisons indefinitely without any precise type of accuse formed against them. As Amil Koda was mentioning, for the last sort of week, 10 days, we've been constantly on a daily basis reading in the news, Reuters has been reporting, that all of a sudden, South Korean cars are no longer safe and South Korean destinations are no longer interesting from a tourist perspective. As a matter of fact, I should point out that again, Reuters pointed out that Chinese authorities have given a 7-point verbal instruction to travel agencies operating in China and including a South Korean tourist destination to erase those safe destinations out of their activities if they so wish to continue to operate in the country. And incidentally, because it is fashionable to talk about the South China Sea, and apparently you cannot go with a talk without mentioning it, notwithstanding Bill Hayton retaining the supreme control of the issue, it is perhaps also worth mentioning that the Scarborough Shoal was in the news over the last week or so, because we now know that whilst militarization, reclamation, or any type of naughty things that one could have expected to be done upon it, instead of being replaced by the intention of the Chinese government to build an environment monitoring station. An interesting concept. It depends if it comes with landing strips and missile batteries next to it to protect it against naughty fishermen from other countries. So in a way, if you want, one could push the argument that there are already crises unfolding, and it's not that when I was checking the news there were Europeans that were rushing to make a point about what kind of position they had upon them. So that's the first point, clarifying what a crisis is intended for, which I will do in a moment. When it comes to the interest, I think that all these examples that I selected from the news of the last 10 days or so speak volumes, or at least three different type of interests, security interests, broadly defined, that are relevant to a European context. First, issues that are under the framework of the UN, the EU, NATO, or whichever other sort of format that you can think of when you think about Europe, proliferations of both conventional and nuclear capabilities as well as human rights are among those type of issues that generally speaking are considered to be of interest to Europeans. Number two, sets of international liberal order and challenges to it by means of the use of force in order to make a point over territorial maritime claims of sorts. And number three, how these actions in point number two are connected to the challenge that they present the international maritime order as it has been encapsulated into the framework of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, which last time I checked, all single European countries, regardless of their additional affiliations, have signed up to. So, what kind of crisis one should focus on, will focus on for the next sort of 5 to 10 minutes or so. Besides the point of having a discussion about what kind of crisis, for the purpose of this talk and the time that I am allocated, I will focus on the type of crisis that, if they're not already unfolding, they are likely to have potential repercussions in terms of increasing the likelihood of open conflict in the region. And when it comes to Europe, I will focus on Europe in the broadest possible sense. Mostly, however, in military terms, referring back to NATO as the sort of largest framework for conceptualizing Europe as such. So within this definition of what crisis it is that I will be talking about, so crisis that leads to military escalation, I think there are three different type of potential crisis that should be of interest from a European perspective. One, existing, ongoing, and unlikely to go away maritime and territorial disputes, both in the East and the South China Sea. Sorry, Bill, can I mention it? You're right? Thanks. Number two, outstanding Cold War issues, North Korea and Korean Peninsula affairs, and Taiwan Strait issues. Have you heard President Tsai wants to build submarines? All that sort of thing. The Beijing people went mad. All right. And number three, I think there's a three category, the third category that concerns issues that are related to the current ongoing debate over the redefinition of power balance in the region and what it says by association for the rest of the world, and that is potential conflicts that will see the United States pitched against China. Now, of these three categories, I think the third one is the least likely to happen in the near future, other than in the context of conflict by proxy. And the proxy being one of the previous two, either maritime or territorial disputes. The United States, after all, is an ally of Japan, which incidentally has a territorial maritime disputes with China and technically Taiwan. And it is also a security partner of the Philippines, which has an outstanding maritime and territorial disputes with the PRC and technically Taiwan. So let's focus on the two different type of crisis. Insofar as the maritime and territorial outstanding disputes are concerned, we are looking at two different type of developments. In East China Sea, there is a relatively stable yet progressively increasing pace of law enforcement and military activities inside the territorial waters and in the vicinity of the territorial waters of the Senkaku Islands, known in China as Diaoyu. In particular, over 2016 and 2017, we've seen a transformation of what the pre-existing routinized pattern of three incursions by three ships for 2 hours every month. We have started to move towards a routine of four ships, 2 hours inside of the territorial waters. The extra additional ship, usually including a former frigate with armed equipment on top, notably 38 millimeter Gatling guns. So, insofar as this China Sea is concerned, while the situation on the surface appears stable, this is all because at the Japanese end, there is a clear policy decision to self-restrain the behavior and the reaction, fundamentally limiting to just a pushback of what the Chinese counterparts are doing. But that does not make it a stable situation. And as I said, trends suggest that the pattern of deployments of forces inside the waters and around them is only likely to increase. So the question is, up until now, we have a pattern of ships entering and going out after a couple of hours. What happens the day that those ships, particularly if one of them is a 12,000-ton Coast Guard cutter currently deployed in the East China Sea Coast Guard fleet of China, decides to actually drop anchor rather than moving out? In the South China Sea, as I briefly mentioned, I think the hotspots, and the Admiral also was making the point earlier on, it's a slightly different, because there is not so much the activity or law enforcement and military forces, rather is the actions in terms of the reclamation and militarization of features in the area. In this regard, what is likely to be the hotspots in the foreseeable future, it is definitely the Scarborough Shoal, because of the reasons that Admiral Koda mentioned and which I will not further elaborate in the moment. And again, in that respect too, there is absolutely no indication, and Bill's graphics actually were very telling in this respect, that that pattern is likely to change. What about the second category of crisis that I mentioned, the ones concerning the outstanding Cold War issues, as I call them? Well, North Korea has been relatively active. We know that out of the recent, first of all, 2016 was, for the records, was the year whereby North Koreans have done the most missile tests compared to the previous decade, just in 1 year, just to give you a sense of the pace of change in that regards. But what is even more interesting is that the latest successful missile launches clearly suggest that North Koreans are now putting within their sights the targeting of American bases in Japan, which raises the stakes, at least conventionally, in terms of the potential for escalation. And indeed, if this was not enough, it is quite openly stated that the current administration in the United States is reviewing its policy towards North Korea, widening the canvas of potential options, going from a military action for regime change to recognizing North Korean nuclear status. And provided the fact that half of the senior positions, both the State Department and DOD for the Asia-Pacific, are still empty, I'm not necessarily comfortable about the fact that the canvas has been so widened. So in regards to both these issues, I think we've got enough on the plate to consider that in the nearby future, questions will be asked to the Europeans to do something more if the current situation, as I introduced at the beginning in terms of crisis existing, is not enough. Oh, by the way, I did not mention Taiwan, but again, there we've got a situation at the moment that with the election of President Tsai of the DPP, for the first time in about a decade, there is a changing relationship across the Taiwan Straits. Certainly, there is a much greater sense coming from the Taiwanese. There is an intention to reinvest in modernizing their military forces and trying to establish a new type of dialogue and interaction with the PRC. Obviously, Taiwan being the long-standing, temporarily unavailable province from the annual telephone yearbook in China, that still leaves the door open with the complexity of the issue itself. So what it is, if we move on, once we identify a potential crisis that could lead to conflict, what it is the expectation from the Europeans? I think the expectation can be divided, broadly speaking, into two different categories. An expectation for the Europeans in different guises to be at the sort of conservative end of the spectrum as a normative power, as a normative and political entity, and the slightly more pretentious expectation that the Europeans actually do provide some sort of military role for themselves. And I should say that I am of a slightly different opinion. Actually, I think that it's the military role that Europe can play is well beyond the question of being symbolic or token. Actually, I think it can be substantial, and I'll come back to this point in a second. When we're talking about normative and political dimension, I think that should come in the guise of two possible ways. One is to, as Admiral Koda was mentioning earlier on, was to provide the political support to actors in the region and outside the region that actually stand for the fundamental principles that we're all signed up to. I'll give you an example of what it is that I am not talking about, and that is the 15th of July statement coming out of the EU, which acknowledged the ruling of the International Tribunal. That was the best that came out of Europe. Frankly, it would have been better for people just to shut up. It's one of those cases where silence actually is a better choice. There's a valor in that too. So I think in that respect, if you really want to stand up as a normative power, you have to find ways to make certain kind of statements. And some individual European actors did as much in that context, but overall, if this is the expectation for the conservative side of being there, we kind of failed on this particular occasion. So I think that's a good lessons learned. If there's a the roadmap of things to do, that is not the way to follow. But there is also another way in which politically and from a normative perspective, Europe can actually be involved, and that is certainly in its role of supporting regional actors in the ways of their trying to proactively pursue stability both in the South and the East China Sea, and more broadly in the East Asian or Asia Pacific region. Here I'm talking about Japan, Australia, and certainly to an extent India, countries that have long-standing defense and security partnership and close ties with a number of European countries. I can think of Australia and the UK, I can think of Japan, Australia and the UK and France, I can think of India and the UK. So besides all sorts of other formats, incidentally, NATO's four global partners, four of NATO's global partners are in that part of the world, and they include Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and South Korea. So it's not that we don't really have the avenues to do that, right? These things are already there. So just by supporting politically the actions that regional actors are taking, I think that already would meet the degree of expectations that exist in the region for a European role. So clear positions and matters of principle and supporting regional actors is that in that conservative understanding of what a European role could be, I think is the minimum. But Europe can be more ambitious than that. I believe in it. Yes, that's my sales pitch, right?
I buy that.
Thank you. And, you know, if you don't believe me, you should believe the Admiral, frankly. That's the thing. And I think here the effort should focus on crisis mitigation, as it is known in the NATO parlance of last hour, rather than crisis reaction. We know that everybody can somehow cope in the developed world, can cope with a major crisis. I mean, we can open a debate about the last 15 years or so, but overall, I would say that if push comes to shove, people actually can roll up their sleeves and do something about it. But why should we wait for a crisis to happen? We know that the terrain is quite fertile in terms of potential crises. Why not to try to focus on preventing them from taking place in the first place? And that's where militarily, I think, there's a place for Europe, whether bilaterally or through NATO. Now let me focus on three aspects. One, taking advantage, well, first of all, that requires a preliminary exercise, which is some sort of a strategic mapping of all the activities that Europeans are already conducting in that part of the world. As it happens, there are actually lots of training activities, ship visits, rotations, capacity building programs, exercises that are built on the back of existing agreements. The Europeans actually are there. At the moment, you've got an Italian frigate in Singapore, you've got a French Mistral-class ship with two British helicopters and 80 Marines on top, somewhere in the middle of the South China Sea. Got lots of stuff. Unbelievable. I mean, if the Italians are down there, it means that really the Europeans are there, right? Really? Truth to be told, it's just by sheer coincidence. But anyways, point is that mapping the activity is essential in order to try to understand how to take maximum benefit out of it. As being a constructive regional cluster power, if you want, seeking to engage the various actors to do the sorts of things that the Admiral and many others today have mentioned. But I think more importantly, the second level of activities, which includes three aspects. One, training opportunities that increases the level of regional maritime actors, navies, coast guards, and the lot, in order to be able to conduct their business to higher standards. Secondly, capacity building programs and taking advantage of trying to assist local actors, particularly the weaker ones, to increase their ability to deliver stability, governance, and security, to reduce the risk of one actor in particular, to take advantage of their weakness, right? And there's a third level, I think, that could be to be considered, and that is thinking about longer deployments in the region, or, dare I say, deployments in the region, not necessarily of high end of the spectrum type of capabilities. Because if really push comes to shove and we're in a shooting fight, hey, the amount of military concentration of power in the region will mean that if we send the whole of the Royal Navy or the Italian Navy or the French Navy, it's not going to make massively a difference, to be perfectly honest. I mean, that's the military balance since 2012. They keep saying the same thing over and over again. We're just not listening. But what really would make a difference is capabilities that can perform all sorts of governance and maritime security operation related activities, which would contribute to showing that the Europeans do care about maritime governance and they do care about it on an average day. And here I think about the potential, for example, of the UK-Japan cooperation as one that could be used for considering the deployment of assets in the region on a permanent basis to conduct presence, signalling and maritime security operations. And the Royal Navy at the moment is looking at some of its assets that are going to be sort of lightly armored, relatively nimble, ideal for this constabulary type of role. So you can make a difference if crisis mitigation is what we're thinking. Lastly, I think there is a role not just for the individual actors, but for NATO as well. If crisis mitigation is the way to go, I think that NATO's tradition of creating centers of excellence to promote the standardization and the expectation that conduct of operations in the realm of military affairs is of higher and more common standards, then I can see the opportunity, in light of what has been happening in Europe with some of NATO's non-NATO partners, for countries like Japan and Australia to consider creating a center of excellence for maritime capacity building and disaster response, which not only would tie NATO politically to keeping an eye on things happening in that part of the world, but at the same time, it would allow regional actors to do what they are already doing, channeling their energies and creating a more conducive environment whereby we're not talking about containing China, but we're talking about creating better governance and stability for everyone. I don't know if I met the requirements of delivering what the chairman asked me to do, but I think that in light of what we've been discussing so far, this is as best I could do. I hope you had a good time, and I'm looking forward to the questions to come. Thank you very much.
Alessio, thank you. You failed in one respect in that it's now 25-4, but I think you succeeded admirably in summing up what the potential is for the EU to do. And I think taking that alongside the very clear exposition that the Admiral gave us of what's likely to happen, where it's likely to happen, what the potential is for a crisis. We've looked at a number of options for responding to the crisis. Perhaps one area we've not focused on is what is the precipitating factor. What are the red lines? How much of what's been going on can we go on soaking up? How does China know it's going too far if it's actually not meeting any level of resistance? I think that points to a rather sensitive area of international relations, which plays to back channels rather than public discussion, and it tends to focus on if you go near this, you will suffer consequences. And there is opportunities for exemplary violence within a contained situation. So I'm not constructing that sort of scenario, but if you're on a slippery slope, at some point you have to drive a peg in. And I think it's not clear either to China or to ourselves what that might be. So a small and politically unacceptable thought. But your questions, please, to our very successful panel. Archibald.